Great to see so many familiar faces, great to see so many students and so many people from organisations that I've worked with in the past. It's just great to see over a 30-year period, so it's welcome again to JCU. Today we're talking about, and Mark said to me, there's a talk about engagement and stakeholders. He talked to me, and I said to him straight away, I'd like to do something in this, because I'd like to give you an example of what I think is a really good example of a partnership and what it means to build partnerships. I think a lot of us in the sort of areas like universities or institutions, we use words very loosely like, I'd like to start a partnership. It's a bit like speed dating. We do speed dating, by the way, too. They're short term, or they'll never happen. But a real relationship and a partnership in research means a lot of work. And it really means a long build-up period. It means a time of a lot of talking, and it means the establishment of real trust between partners, if it's going to work. So I don't think we should bang these words around too much. It's a very serious business. And hopefully a good partnership will last outside of the research or whatever the initial thing is. So I'd like to give an example of that, of the one that we're doing at the moment, which I think fits the bill. Because if we go back, and I remember a guy called Darren Cassowary, Darren, I know he's here, the guy in the suit. And he came to us 2 years ago, and he started talking to Mark and I very informally. This is how these things start. He says, we've got a problem, Glenn, with the QPS, about police being assaulted. We're very, very worried about the number of police officers, men and women, it doesn't matter anymore, whether you're a man or a woman, you get assaulted if you're a police officer. And I know frontline people now are getting assaulted everywhere. Ambulance drivers, ambulances are getting assaulted, people in the front of the triage at the hospital, and even school teachers and principals are getting other victims of assault. So there's a rise in violence across our community, you can't ignore it. Okay? And it's driven by a whole heap of very, very factors, interlocking factors, some of which is drugs and alcohol, some of which is anger, and some of which is around mental health issues. So we looked at this project, he came to us and said, what can we do? I said, well, what we can do is find out first of all what police officers who have been assaulted and what their perceptions are. So it's a multifaceted research project. We're now almost at the end of year one, it'll go on a bit further, we'll kick it along a bit further because we're not quite finished with the business. And I said to the police, we'll talk to the police, but I think we need to also go to the other side of the fence, so to speak, and I use that word loosely, when we'll go into prisons and talk to people who have assaulted the police, the people themselves, the actual assaulters. And we'll also look at some third-party stuff around the use of body camera images, and also we'll look at some tests, which are driven from about attitudinal tests from prisoners and police, about their attitudes towards authority, etc. So it's a multifaceted thing, which brings into play a really exciting project around interdisciplinary. So we have a psychologist on board, that's a good thing, because I'm not one. We have a sociologist, we have a criminologist, we have a PhD student, and we have the police, who've been terribly helpful. Darren Patterson has driven this on a pristine colour. And that's been the team. When we formed the team, I said, this will be the team. Everybody's included, everybody has a role. So what we've done to this point, I'm not going to tell you the results today, because that's the next talk I do. And it's really around interviewing 10 police officers from Mount Isa, from Cairns, from Townsville and Mackay, who have all been victims of assaults. And I've done most of those interviews myself, and it really unpacks a lot of stuff, particularly around the impact on people who carry these scars with them into their private lives, and also into their professional lives. Things we don't hear about. Because the police are tough nuts, right? They have this exterior thing, but they say they know about police. They don't like to divulge and stuff to show it. But these people are just people like everybody else. They don't come to work, as they say, and come home to their families as an assault victim. Very interesting as well, the last 2 weeks I've spent time talking to prisoners. I've spent time at Lotus Glen, there's an experience just getting in there, getting out there again. Or going into Rockhampton Correctional Centre, I'll be in the Townsend one as well soon, talking to and have spoken to the people who have done the assaults. And I walk out of there every time and I feel very, very sad. I think this person has been a victim themselves in many ways, in terms of the way they were brought up. I'm not making excuses for assaulting people. Their background is being victims of assaults themselves or sexual assaults, and have spent many of them, their lives graduating, recycling through the system in terms of going to Queensland Detention Centre, which is out of North Queensland, and spending most of their lives in and out of jail. Some up to 10 to 12 occasions in and out of jail. That's life. If that was your life, you wouldn't think it was too much. And I said to a guy the other day, as I was leaving, the last question in the tape player was off, I said to him, what happens to you when you leave here? He was leaving in 3 days for the fifth time. He says, what do you get? I said, what's the leg up to when you leave here? And he said this. He said they give us $100 cash. They give us a one-way bus ticket and a ride into Mareeba to catch the bus. And if we have a cheque of work that we redundant prison, which may be $100 or $200, and then we go to point B where we actually came from. That's we're supposed to start again. So we need to think very seriously as well about the people who are churning out prisons and actually what happens to those people and why they come back. Because it's not a good deal. Spending $100,000 a year to house a prisoner in jails in Queensland. Taxpayers' dollars, all of us work, or some of us do, and those who do and pay taxes know what I mean. $100,000 a year when we're looking at more creative ways of dealing with people with these sorts of problems. We need to delve into mental health issues. We need to look at rehabilitation around drugs and alcohol. And the scourge of ICE is a really big problem. When I talk to police today, especially the older ones, they say, all we had to deal with in the 70s was the old stoned junkie marijuana user who just wanted to go to sleep and find a packet of biscuits. Anything happened. Today, the ICE user is a different kettle of fish. If you're dealing with ICE users, the police say sometimes it might take five officers to bring down one ICE user due to their human strength. These are changed times. Changed times for being in this business. I'm proud to be in the forefront of working with QCS. I'm very, very happy to work with them and continue working with QPS in particular, the saving the drivers behind us. And we have the firm foundations by having an authentic relationship, which hopefully will be ongoing, based on trust, setting the ground rules and making sure everybody knows what they have to do. So they don't we have to deliver, but they have to deliver too, in terms of this relationship. That's the nature of a good research relationship. The results, I'll tell you next time around. Thanks very much.